Subhash, in trying to understand aesthetics, which to me is a wonderful representation of what consciousness is for human beings, there are many different ways to approach it. But more modernly, people look at neuroscience and physics in a physical way. But then there are the ancient traditions, Vedic tradition, I know you're a scholar of. How do you look upon aesthetics as a scientist and as a Vedic scholar?
To me, aesthetics is what puts us in touch with the universal. And all literature, for example, or painting or sculpture, which brings the universal to us, is what enlarges us. It makes us more than what we are ordinarily in our skin and bones. And novels, for example, we cry with the characters of the novel, even though we know that they were the figment of the imagination of the writer. And so the question then arises, how can the creative individual create forms which would be helpful to the viewer or the reader to be connected to the infinite potential that resides within oneself? In the Indian tradition, and there were theorists who spoke about how all of this should be done, the idea was that if you're trying to teach about the greatest mystery of it all, which is the mystery of our own selves, the best way to do it is not to do it directly, but do it indirectly through suggestion. So the whole idea of music, for example, or painting, or sculpture, was to create a surface structure which was not sort of self-evident, but from which, if upon reflection or upon enough thinking about it, one could go to the deeper, inexpressible sense, which is universal. And having gone to that sense, one would be transformed oneself. So all of art was a way for self-transformation. So it had a utilitarian objective, one could say. It was not just to be viewed and then to walk past. So, and from that perspective, I suppose all of education is that. All of education is for each one of us to realize one's potential. And I don't think that's any different now than what it was in ancient times.
To Westerners who first see some Indian art, it looks disturbing. You have figures, human figures with multiple limbs. What is the artistic meaning of that?
The human figures with multiple limbs, for example, four arms, they were a representation of the universe. You know, four arms are the four cardinal directions. And so there's a lot of abstract code which goes into it. And if one is sort of informed of what that code is, then you can make sense of it. But I think the other objective that this art had was that if you were to see that what you were viewing was very different from what ordinary reality looks like, perhaps this would induce you to ask a deeper question. Why is it different? What is the meaning of it all? Why is the elephant-headed god named Ganesha riding a rat? Because how is that possible? Here is this huge being. So clearly the objective was to make you ask the question, what does it really mean? And this was also traditionally expressed in terms of six different ways of approaching reality, like the six sides of a cube. And these six different ways were yoga on one side, which is about synthesis within ourselves of our own restructured self, and Sankhya, which was analysis and creation, both at the personal level and at the universal level. Two other planes were logic, because what is reality? You can ask about it by asking, what is logic? You know, what do we mean by statements? Mm-hmm. What do we mean by grammar? And on the other side, physics, because that is the logic of materiality. And two other sides was Mimamsa, which is tradition. You can also ask, why do we do whatever we do at our home, in our society, in our culture? And all of those things can help us reach a deeper understanding. And on the other side was Vedanta, which was the deepest question of it all. What is reality? And so there were these complementary views which were essential to the comprehensive Hindu Vedic approach to life and reality.